You are now tuned in to the Next Dimension University broadcast. Come out of the Godnosphere and experience the next dimension in destiny with us. Be empowered and educated through any of the 61 and growing ministry career fields. We are a school of purpose. We are a school of destiny. We are poised and ready to prepare, equip, empower, and deploy you into your kingdom assignment. We are the lowest cost, fully accredited Bible college in Southern California today. And now, join us as your destiny begins.
Okay, this is Dr. Joel McLeod. I'm the Chancellor of Next Dimension University, your school of destiny. We're excited about this discourse that's going to be here today at the Next Dimension University General Assembly. We have an awesome guest speaker, Pastor Fred Price Jr., and he's going to be talking about prophetic mentoring in the Word of God. He's also going to be covering pneumatology and also the theology of tongues. So you want to not miss out on this opportunity to be under the Godnosphere and learn these awesome prophetic principles from our own Pastor Fred Price Jr. Well, friend of mine, hang out for the next half an hour and get the message.
Is it okay if I teach today? Is that okay? Is that okay? First, let me establish this. I am a doctor. Now, what does he mean when he says that? I'm not talking about the degree that our chancellor bestowed upon me. I'm not talking about that degree. But I am a biblical doctor. Chancellor is a biblical doctor. What I'm referring to is the didaskalos, which is the Greek word for teacher in Ephesians 4:11. And the literal definition of teacher is instructor, teacher, master, and doctor. Literally, Ephesians 4:11, Jesus gave some to be doctors, doctors in the church. Now, what do doctors do? What do doctors do? Anyone? Doctors heal, fix, diagnose. Now, take all of these words that you know and apply that to scripture and apply that to teaching and apply that to the text. And notice that not all are called to be doctors. Only some are called to be instructors in the Word of God. And it's a wonderful thing when you know your lane and you know your place in the body. The scripture says when every joint supplies and every part does its share, it causes growth of the body. One of the problems we have in the body of Christ are people trying to get over into others' lanes. But if everyone would stay in their lane, all right, then we would see growth throughout the body. So I know my lane. As of right now, I am not called to the office of apostle. I'm not called to the office of prophet or evangelist, but I have been called to the office of pastor and teacher. And today I'm functioning specifically in the office of teacher. So that's what I'm going to do today. This morning, I'm going to teach, if you're okay with that. Amen. Okay, 1 Corinthians 12. Dr. McLeod asked if I would continue on prophetic mentoring. And so it's so apropos for what's going on in my life personally. This is why I was so quick to say yes to the October 22nd date, because some things have been going on in my life prophetically. And so to see and to hear him make the request at that time on this subject, I knew it was the Spirit of God. So I will go ahead and continue. And what I want to highlight is 1 Corinthians 12:4. Now, what we're going to do today is we're going to bring clarity, because there's a lot of confusion. Spirit of God spoke to me as I was sitting there through Dr. McLeod when he mentioned praying in the Spirit. Praying in the Holy Ghost. I want to talk about that today as well. But let's look here at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I want to start with verse 4. And it says, there are diversities of what? Yes. Gifts, but the same who? Spirit. there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are diversities of, literally, charisma. That's the Greek. Verse 5. There are differences of what? Some of your texts may say ministries. Some may say administrations. So ministries or administrations. There are differences of ministries or administrations, but the same who? The same Lord. Ministries or administrations is the Greek word diakonia. And then we have in verse 6, and there are diversities of what? Some of your texts may say activities. Others may say operations. There are diversities of activities or operations. Greek word energema literally means workings. Okay. But the same who? God, who works all in all. Now, one of the things that I want you to do as students of the word is pay attention to text patterns in Scripture. Pay attention to patterns. You notice in these three verses, the Spirit is identified, the Lord is identified, and God is identified. Three, Spirit, Lord, God. Now, with a little deductive reasoning, we can come to the conclusion that each person of the Godhead is being highlighted in these three verses. It appears that the gifts come under the jurisdiction of the Holy Spirit, according to verse 4. It appears that the differences of ministries or administrations, highlighted in verse 5, come under the jurisdiction of the Lord Jesus the Christ. And then in verse 6, there are diversities of activities or operations. They seem to come under the jurisdiction of Abba, of Father God. So the Spirit oversees the gifts. The Lord oversees the administrations or ministries. And the Father oversees the operations or the activities. Now we want to highlight the difference between gifts. As a matter of fact, they're all referred to as gifts, but one set is referred to as the gifts of the Spirit, another set the administrations of the Lord, another set the operations of the Father. And we want to break all of these down and highlight them so that we can bring clarity to lanes, because sometimes people think they're called to be something they're not called to be. And you don't need to take offense at the fact that you may not be called to be something you thought you were called to be. Because if everyone truly desires to please the Lord, you want to be right where he desires you to be. Okay. So let's look here at verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. Pay attention to this. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. Now, I want to stress something here. There is division, and not in a negative sense, but there's division in the body as to what this actually means. Now, I'm going to bring to you what I firmly believe it means. I'll stand on it for eternity. I would debate anyone, not that I'm looking to enter into a foolish dispute, because they just generate envy and cause strife. The Bible says so. But I have no problem with having a discussion for clarity's sake on biblical subject matter. But I firmly believe what I'm about to share with you regarding the gifts of the Spirit specifically. And I'm going to show you why I believe this and relate that to the gifts of the Lord or the Son and the gifts of the Father. And I believe that you'll see that which I'm articulating to you. when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit only, do not think that you own these gifts. Do not think you own them. Now, it's interesting. I just had a discussion with two friends of mine, and I respect them. They're very astute in the word. They disagree with me on this, but I'm going to once again stand on my position and let the text do what? Let the text speak for itself. Now, let's go with the idea. Let's go with the idea that we do own the gifts of the Spirit. In other words, the gift is mine to possess and wield whenever I determine. Let's say that is the case. If so, that means we only have one gift. Why? Because that's what the language gives. That's what the language speaks. Notice in verse 8, it says, to one is given. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We're going to use these nine people. According to this language, if I own the gift, I could only own one. Because the scripture says, to one is given. To one is given what? Word of wisdom. It says then, to another. So that means that if she has the word of wisdom, she can't have anything else. So she has the word of wisdom. To another is given the word of knowledge. To another is given what? Faith. To another is given what? Healings. To another is given what? Working of miracles. To another what? Prophecy. To another what? Discerning of spirits. To another what? Diverse kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. So if I walk away from this text with the idea that I own the gift, then I also must walk away with the idea that I only own one. And if I only own one, I can't operate in the other eight. Because he said, to one is given. Now, one of the definitions for given is to bestow upon, right? So to one is given, to one is given, to another is given, to another is given, to another is given. If I walk away, once again, with the idea that I own the gifts, then I need to walk away with the idea that I only own one and I can't be used in another. Now, if we stay right there, then that's what we'll walk away with. But if we continue to read, we'll realize that's not what Paul's saying. Paul's not saying that you only have one gift and you own it. No, here's what Paul is saying. Paul is saying that inside of you is the Holy Spirit and he has the nine. And as he wills, he will work through any of you, any of the nine. Let's continue with the text to prove that. All right, watch this. Let's focus on verse 11 again. But one and the same Spirit works all these things. Who's working these things? I'm not working them. He's working them. The Spirit of God on the inside of me is working the miracle. Let me give you an example of what I mean. Look at Acts chapter 2. I figure if this applies to Jesus and I fall under him, I come under Jesus. I come behind Jesus. Now, yes, I'm seated in heavenly places with him. I'm one with Christ. But the point I'm making is any ministry function would not work more in me beyond Christ. I would not have a greater measure than him. Okay. Look at Acts 2 and look at the 22nd verse. All right. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you. How? How was he attested? By miracles and wonders and signs, which who did through him? Say that again. Isn't it interesting that the text doesn't say that Jesus did them? Rather, it says God did those things through him. As you yourselves also know. God did through him in your midst. God did through. God did through him. God did through him. Look at Mark 16. Some would debate and say, well, these last verses in Mark 16 weren't in the original autographs. Okay, that's fine. My thing is this, is even if it wasn't written in the original autographs, can I find it anywhere else in Scripture and it be confirmed? And if it can be confirmed, then I can still take this as relative. No, I can take this as valid. Okay, let's see. Mark 16, verse 19. This is after he says, here's what I want you to do. Go into the world, preach the gospel to every creature, do these things. Verse 19. So then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. All right. He wasn't confirming me. He wasn't confirming them. He was confirming the word through them. Confirming the word through them. Right. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God. By what? Miracles, signs, and wonders which God did through. Back to the gifts of the Spirit. He works these things, right? Distributing to each one individually as he wills. So if the Spirit of God wants to work a miracle through her, he'll do so. But if he also wants to work discerning of spirits through her, he'll do so. It's not that she only has discerning of spirits and can't function in the other eight. No, who she has is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is on the inside of her, but the Holy Spirit has nine gifts, and he will manifest any of those nine through whomever he wills. Now, the thing about the gifts of the Spirit is that they are very precise, accurate, and meticulous. So the prophecy that's mentioned here is a prophecy that can only be uttered as he wills, not as you will. That's it. If you will it, it's not a gift of the Spirit. If you will it, it's a gift of the Father. Okay. And there's nothing wrong with prophesying in proportion to your faith, as Chancellor was just speaking about. There's nothing wrong with that. The problem is when I attribute to the Holy Spirit that which only came as a result of my faith. Therein lies the problem. If I'm prophesying according to my faith, then I need to make it known that I'm prophesying according to my faith, not I'm prophesying under inspiration of the Holy Spirit. There needs to be clarity on that. Are you guys with me still? All right, head back over to 1 Corinthians 12. Okay. Now, look here at verse 27. Says, now you are who? You're the body of Christ. And members individually. And God has appointed these in the church. In other words, this is how the church was established. All right, it began with the apostles. Okay. God has appointed these in the church first. Okay, this is not a ranking system we're reading here. It's not a ranking system, because if it's a ranking system, then God is confused. And you and I know that God isn't confused. This couldn't be a ranking system, because this ranking system or this order differs from Ephesians 4:11. So that's how you know it's not a ranking system, because in this list, teachers are mentioned third. In Ephesians 4, teachers are mentioned fifth. So you know it's not about a ranking. This is about an appointing. Ephesians 4 was about a giving. Are we clear on that? Okay. And God has appointed these in the church. First, he appointed apostles, right? Because apostles were the sent ones. That's what apostle means. Apostolos. It means messenger. So the apostolos, they went out first. They were the sent ones. The word of God was given to them. They went out. They established it. Next, prophets were appointed. Prophets came in under inspiration by the Holy Spirit. Literally, prophetis. It means inspired speaker. All right. Not just a foreteller of future things, but an inspired speaker. You can be a prophet and not necessarily speak of things to come. Prophets also speak under inspiration of the Holy Spirit. One of the things that prophets get things by revelation that others require study for. I had a friend of mine that taught something that I had discovered in my own study time. I said, hey, man, when did you study that? He said, no, I just got that on the spot. So that which I had studied to attain, or that which I had studied to find out, the Spirit of God gave it to him like that. See, that's prophetic, right? Receiving revelation under inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not telling you not to study. because the Bible says study to show yourself approved. I'm just saying that those of you who may be given to the office of prophet, you need to understand that some things are just going to come to you under inspiration. Okay. So the prophets would come and do what? Confirm the word that the messengers delivered. And then you have the teachers. What did the teachers do? The teachers, you all said what doctors do, right? That's what the teachers would do. All right. Notice what it says next. Then it says, then gifts of healing and miracles, or after that miracles, then gifts of healing. Now, isn't it interesting how it switches from administrations to gifts? Isn't it interesting? You see that pattern? Remember, always pay attention to scriptural patterns. And God has appointed these in the church. First apostle, that's an administration. Second prophets, that's an administration. Third teachers, that's an administration. How come it didn't say fourth? The evangelist and the pastor, how come they're not mentioned? They're not mentioned in name, but they are mentioned in fruit. Because in the office of evangelists, there are certain gifts that will be present more than others. And in the office of evangelists, you are going to see the miracles and the gifts of healings in operation more than other gifts, right? Not to the exclusion of other gifts, but more than other gifts. So literally after that, you can read after that evangelist, because out of the office of evangelism or the out of the office of the evangelists, you'll often see the miracles and the gifts of healing. And then the pastors come last in this list because the helps in the administrations. All right. Those are governments that falls under the pastoral responsibility. All right. Then it says varieties of tongues. And then some questions are asked. And here's where some confusion comes throughout the body of Christ about whether we should all be speaking with tongues. Let me go ahead and tell you now, all of us should be praying in the Spirit, praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in the Holy Spirit, speaking in the Spirit, however you want to word it. The Bible calls it all of that. We all should be. So we're going to read some questions and you need to know where these questions apply. Let me help you out with this. Verse 29. I'll ask you the question. You give me the answer. Are all apostles?
No.
Very good. Are all prophets?
No.
Very good. Are all teachers?
No.
Outstanding. Are all workers of miracles?
No.
Outstanding. Do all have gifts of healings?
No.
All right. Now don't get lost here. Do all speak with tongues?
Yes.
No. Remember, follow the pattern. Follow the pattern. Do all interpret?
No.
So think about this. Ask yourself the question, why would the answers to all these questions be no, but only yes to one? Doesn't make sense. Because what's being asked here is not do all pray in the Spirit. What's being asked here is are all used in the gift of diverse kinds of tongues? And the answer is no. Just like everyone is not used in the gift of miracles. Everyone's not used in the gifts of healing. As a matter of fact, let's go back to the list here in verse 8, 9, and 10, and we can read it like this. Are all used in the gift of word of wisdom? No. Are all used in the gift of word of knowledge? No. Are all used in the gift of faith? No. Are all used in the gift of healings? No. Are all used in the gift of working of miracles? No. Are all used in the gift of prophecy? No. Are all used in the gift of discerning of spirits? No. Are all used in the gift of different kinds of tongues? No. No. Are all used in the gift of interpretation of tongues? No, all are not used in all gifts because he distributes them as he wills. This is not talking about what Chancellor was talking about earlier when he said pray in the Holy Ghost. What he was talking about was the initial evidence of being filled with the Spirit. This is your prayer language where Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14:4, go right over there. He says, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. You see, in our own prayer time, we've all heard it, prayer closet, prayer room. In your personal prayer time, all believers should be praying in the Spirit because all believers should be filled with the Spirit. The gift of different kinds of tongues is not for you personally. The gifts of the Spirit, the Bible is clear, is for the profit of all. So different kinds of tongues is for a public setting. And so since it's talking about the public gift of the Spirit, different kinds of tongues, no, all don't speak with tongues. But if you're talking about edifying yourself, yes, all should. Jude even echoes this. Look at Jude. If anyone ever says, go to the book of Jude chapter, anything beyond one, get up and leave the room. Jude 20. Let's kind of expound upon some of the things Chancellor was speaking about when he said, and now you praise in the Holy Ghost, he can eliminate the junk, right? He can focus in on the Spirit, right? How often does he do it? If you ask him, he lives a life of it. See, I live a life of praying in the Spirit. We're not talking about the gift of different kinds of tongues, because the nine gifts are for a public setting to edify all. But you praying in the Spirit privately is to edify you. Let me show you the difference between praying in the Spirit and different kinds of tongues. This is praying in the Spirit. It comes out of your spirit, out of your mouth, into heaven to edify you. But different kinds of tongues comes down from heaven into your spirit, out of your mouth, to edify all. That's the difference. Now, verse 20, listen, but you, who's Jew talking to? Oh, he's talking to me. He's talking to you. He's talking to the church. He says, but you. Then he says, beloved. I know he's talking about me now. I know he's talking about you. But you, beloved, pay attention. Building yourselves up. Stop right there. Doesn't that sound like edification? Yes. Right? He who speaks in a tongue does what? He edifies himself. Yes. You, beloved, do what? You build yourself up. Notice who the responsibility is on. Yes. On you. Didn't say God's going to do it. Say, you, beloved, build yourself up. You, beloved, you build yourself up. Okay, how? Let's continue. On your what? Okay, let's talk about this most holy faith for just a second. It's the only time it's mentioned in the Bible, in verse 20 of Jude. Now, faith, we all know what faith is, right? It's the substance of things hoped for. Right, the evidence of things not seen. So Hebrews 11:1 tells me that faith is both substance and evidence. So substance is tangible, right? That's what substance means. And evidence is proof. So faith is proof that something exists. But faith is also tangibility. Tangibility of what? Of something invisible. Just because something's invisible doesn't mean it's not real. Because Romans 1:20 says that his invisible attributes are clearly seen by the things which were made. So I can look at the tree, and that is evidence of the invisible. Because it's the invisible that creates the visible. So faith, while invisible, does not mean that something doesn't exist. Why? Because the Bible just called it substance and evidence. Okay. So faith is substance and faith is evidence. And then there's a scripture in Romans 12:3 that says you've been dealt the measure of faith. Well, measure means amount or quantity. So that tells me then that measures can be decreased or increased. Now, God himself is not going to increase your faith. A question was asked to Jesus, increase our faith. And Jesus brings up a mustard seed. How small is a mustard seed? A mustard seed is small, so small that right now, if I told you one was on my fingertip, you couldn't tell from where you're seated. And he said, with mustard seed faith, you can move a mountain. So they ask the question or make the request, Jesus, increase our faith. And he says, you haven't even done with mustard seed faith what you need to do, and you want me to increase it. Well, guess what we find out in Scripture? We found out in Scripture that the measure has already been dealt to us. God has dealt you the measure you need. It's up to you throughout your life as a believer in this earth to develop that measure. Now, we know that there are different kinds of measures in Scripture because the Bible says Abraham was strong in faith and not weak in faith. So it's possible to have weak faith and it's possible to have strong faith. The woman with the issue of blood, Jesus said her faith was great. Weak faith, strong faith, great faith. Shoot, the Bible talks about world overcoming faith, talks about rich faith, talks about shipwrecked faith. Bible says faith without works is dead. That's dead faith. And here we have most holy faith. Most holy faith is only brought up here, and it is only associated with what? Let's keep reading the rest. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your. Your is a possessive pronoun. That means you own it. Your most holy faith. If it's your most holy faith, then you have most holy faith. And the scripture is about to tell you how to build yourself up on that which is already yours. How do you do it? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, why would God only want some of us built up and not others? So this has nothing to do with 1 Corinthians 12:28, where the question was asked, do all speak with tongues? It's not talking about praying in the Spirit in your own personal life. Every Spirit-filled believer should pray in the Spirit to edify themselves and to build themselves up on their most holy faith. Now, let me tell you a little something about most holy faith and also about praying in the Spirit. Because, you know, we talk about praying in the Spirit, but do we know what's going on in the spirit realm when we're praying in the Spirit? All right, I'll give you a little insight. We don't have time to go to the verses, but I'll mention them for you. Okay, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2 says this. When I speak in a tongue, I do not speak to man. I speak to God. However, in the spirit, I speak mysteries. Greek word, mysterion, which means secrets which have been divinely revealed. See, secular or sense realm mysteries are designed to remain mysteries. They're designed to remain hidden and to remain concealed. But the mysteries of God are not designed to remain concealed. They're designed to be divinely revealed. So when you pray in the Spirit, you're speaking mysteries, secrets which have been divinely revealed. Now, the Bible also tells me in 1 Corinthians, starting with chapter 2, starting with verse 6, it words it like this. You can read verse 6 throughout the rest of the chapter. It says this. We speak not the wisdom of this age. Now, that right there should tell you that you're supernatural. Because you live in this age, yet you speak the wisdom of another one. Age also means world. So you live in this world, but you speak the language of another world. Because see, the language of faith is a language of another age, another world, another realm. Are you with me? He says it like this, around verse 6, verse 7, and verse 8. He says, however, or albeit, we speak the wisdom of God hidden in a mystery. Okay, if I speak the wisdom of God hidden in a mystery, I must ask myself the question, when do I speak in mysteries? Oh, I speak in mysteries when I'm praying in the Spirit. And mysteries are secrets which have been divinely revealed. So if the wisdom of God is hidden in a mystery, when I speak the mystery, it's revealed. Are you with me? Now, let me tell you what else God says about those hidden mysteries contained in wisdom, or the hidden wisdom contained in mysteries. He says this, that it was ordained before the ages. Ordained, or what? Or appointed. When you're praying in the Spirit, this is what you need to know. You are praying in the present about your future, which was appointed in the past. Every time you pray in the Spirit, you're praying in the present about your future that was ordained and appointed in the past. Now, in addition to that, what else are you doing? You're interceding. Highest form of intercession is praying in the Spirit. You don't know what to pray about. You don't know who to pray about. You don't know what to pray about who to pray about. But you go with praying in the Spirit, and the Bible says God understands everything you're saying. You're literally praying His perfect will when you're praying in the Spirit. So it's the highest form of intercession. But then let's talk about this most holy faith. Faith is released to receive from God. And in order to receive from God, you have to receive it by faith. So with faith, there's a releasing and a receiving. Right? You release your faith, but you also receive by faith. Are you with me? Right? Faith is released, and then that which you desire or want to receive from God is received by faith. So The thing about praying in the Spirit is it's also a conversation with God. Right. It's a communication. That means sometimes you need to be quiet and let him respond back. You're talking with him. When you pray in the Spirit, guess what you're also doing? You're releasing most holy faith for the unknown, for the mysteries. And you're also receiving those things by most holy faith. Every single person that calls themselves a child of God needs to be filled with the Holy Spirit, because it's the only way to be a witness. Isn't that what Jesus told his disciples? He said, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and then you'll be a witness. You want to be a witness for the kingdom and a witness for Jesus, you need to be filled with the Spirit. I'm going to take it one step further. And if I offend you, I apologize. But if I offend your theology, I don't apologize. If you're not filled with the Spirit, Chancellor, you're not qualified for ministry. You're not qualified. You can't be a witness. Acts 6, the apostles, you know what they said? They said, we don't have time to deal with all these matters. Find us 7 men. What were the qualifications? Full of the Holy Spirit. There were some other things, full of wisdom and some other things, good reputation. But the first thing, full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Spirit. You must be filled with the Spirit. So, back to 1 Corinthians 12, we see here in verse 28, verse 29, verse 30, we clearly see that no, all aren't used in every gift. Now, all are qualified to be used in every gift, but it's as the Spirit wills, right? You may go your whole life. Once again, it's as the Spirit wills. You may go your whole life and the Spirit of God uses you in 8 of the 9 gifts. 8 of them, but never the last one. Why is that? It's as he wills. It's as he wills. He knows the needs of the people when you're around the people. And it's for the profit of all, not the profit of you. It's for the profit of all, not the profit of you. It's for the profit of all, not the profit of you. It's not for your benefit. It's not for your profit. It's not for your gain. It's for their profit. If the Spirit of God right now comes upon me to prophesy to this group of people, it was not for me. It was for you. If he wants to get something to me, he knows how to find me. He knows how to speak to me. But if he wants to get something to you through me, he will will for me or inspire me or compel me to prophesy to you so that you receive edification. Okay. Now, let's end here with these gifts of the Lord and these gifts of the Father. Let's go to the gifts of the Father first. Romans 12. Because I want you to notice something that's present with the gifts of the Father and the gifts of the Son that is absent. The gifts of the Spirit. I need you to see this. Chancellor, let me know. You know, when I don't see a clock, that's the worst thing you can do. Worst thing you can do is give a teacher. You give them time to teach, but you don't show them where his time is. I need a countdown clock. You can't tell me to look at my watch. You can't tell me to look at a clock. I need a timer. Otherwise, I will keep going. You don't have to shut me up. I'm gonna tell you right now. Okay, Romans 12. Look here quickly. Are you guys getting anything out of this? Yes. All right, Romans 12. Look here at verse. Okay, look here at verse 3. Start with verse 3. Romans 12, 3. For I say through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one the measure of faith. Right? There's the measure. All right, verse 4. For as we have many members in one body, all the members do not have the same function. We have the same identification, but we don't have the same function. Always remember that. We have the same what? Identification, but we do not have the same function. Identification is eternal. Function has an expiration date. Identification is eternal. Function has an expiration date. Always remember that. Function has nothing to do with your identification. It doesn't take away from your identification. I'll give you a prime example. How many males do we have in this room? Any males? Raise your hand if you're a male. Okay. Put your hands down. Do we have any females in this room? Raise your hand if you guys already did it. Okay.
I don't know if you guys knew this. I don't know if you knew this, but there are certain functions males have that females don't. And there are certain functions females have that males don't. There are certain functions that males use that women don't. Certain functions females use that men don't. But you're both humans. See, you're identified as members of the human race, but you function as a male, you function as a female. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, so in the body of Christ, there are different functions. There's the function of the pastor and there's the function of the apostle. Now, the apostle and the pastor are both one in Christ, but one functions as an apostle and one functions as a pastor. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, watch this. When the day comes that we're all in New Jerusalem in the holy city, my function as apostle will end. My function as pastor will cease, but I'll always and continuously be one with him. Identification is eternal. Function has an expiration date. Okay. Right? Let's even talk about Jesus. I don't know if you knew this one either. This might be news to you. Present tense. Everyone say now.
Now,
now at this time, Jesus does not function as a sacrifice. It's finished. He functioned as that functions is over. Now, he presently functions as a high priest sitting at the right hand of God, interceding for you and I. He functions as the head of the church. He functions. Are you getting this? Okay. All right. Look here at verse 5. So we being many are one body in Christ, having and individually members of one another, having then gifts differing according to the what? The grace. Notice present is the measure and present is the grace. Look at verse 6. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. Now, let me tell you why you need grace. You need grace for what you possess and you need grace for what you carry. You need grace for what you possess or for what you have and you need grace for what you carry. You carry a mantle. You need grace for that. You need grace for your function. You need grace for that. What's the first thing he says? Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. What's the first thing? If prophecy, let us prophesy how? Not as the Spirit wills, but in this context, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. I can do this all day. I can prophesy according to my faith all day. That's not the Spirit of God using me in prophecy. That's me prophesying out of my own spirit. You see that, right? Ministry, let us minister. Teaching, let us teach. See, that's the difference between being a teacher and having the gift of teaching. See, some are called to be teachers. Some have the gift of teaching. Just because you have the gift of teaching doesn't mean you're a teacher. Just because you prophesy in proportion to your faith, in proportion to your faith doesn't mean you're a prophet. Okay. Just because you evangelize doesn't mean you're an evangelist. Are you with me? Okay. So he says prophecy, ministry, teaching. Look at verse 8. Exhorts. Look at gives. I'm talking about the gift of giving. See, we all give, but there are some with a gift of giving. It's you can't even put it into words when you see them in operation. He who leads. Oh, leadership is a gift. With diligence, he who shows mercy. The gift of mercy. With cheerfulness. See, seven gifts, seven activities, seven operations, seven working, seven energema. Look at Ephesians 4. I believe we can end here. Ephesians 4. Oh, but I need you to look at verse 7. Ephesians 4, 7. And Chancellor, this came to me a couple weeks ago. I saw something present in Ephesians 4. It was present in Romans 12, but it was absent in 1 Corinthians 12. All three talk about gifts, but something was absent in 1 Corinthians 12, which let me know that the gifts in 1 Corinthians 12 you don't have. You're just used in them. The gifts of Romans 12 you have. the gifts in Ephesians 4, you are. Get that. Have, are, used in. Have, are, used in. Romans 12, gifts you have. Ephesians 4, gifts you are. 1 Corinthians 12, gifts you're used in. Okay. Verse 7, right? But to each one of us, what was given? Grace, according to what? Notice, in Romans 12, didn't we read about measuring grace? In Ephesians 4, aren't we reading about measuring grace? But you didn't read anything about measuring grace in 1 Corinthians 12. Because you don't need any grace for the Spirit of God to do what he wants to do. You need grace for what's been given to you to carry. You need grace for what's been given to you to perform. But if the Spirit of God so feels like it working through you, you don't need any grace for it. Because he's going to come upon you when you don't even expect it. You're not carrying anything. He's carrying it. He's just using you. Anyone want to be used? I want to be used. You don't need grace for that. You don't need a measure for that. That's him doing what he wants. But for Romans 12 gifts, you have that. See, you in that sense, you have the gift of prophecy. You have the gift of teaching. You have the gift of leadership. And guess what you need for that? A measure of grace. Well, watch here. Ephesians 4, 7. But to each one of us, what was given? Grace. According to the what? Measure of Christ's gift. All right. Now drop down to verse 11. And he himself did what? He gave some to be. Okay. Your chancellor is a teacher. Now, in my opinion, he's a master teacher. And you might say, well, what qualifies a teacher or a master teacher? Does that mean you could be like an apostle or a prophet or a master prophet? Notice that Greek word, once again, didaskalos, it means master. It means teacher. This is what the disciples called Jesus. They called him rabbi, master, teacher. In so many words, they called him doctor. They called him doctor. Why wouldn't he be a doctor? Luke was a physician. There are doctor terms used in the book of Luke when referring to the ministry of Jesus, especially in that Garden of Gethsemane. If I had time to get into that, it would be eye-opening. Verse 11, he himself gave some to be apostles, gave some to be or some to function as. And as long as we are on this earth, until Christ returns or until you cease to exist, if he's given you to be it, you are that until you leave. There will never be a time while I'm living in this dispensation, there will never be a time I'm not a pastor or a teacher. It's not my identification. It's my function, right? But that's what he's given me to be until. Matter of fact, it says until the unity of the faith. He himself gave some to be apostles, some prophetees. See, the difference between being a prophet, having the gift of prophecy, and being used in prophecy. Gotta know the difference. You have to know the difference, just like you need to know the difference of being used in the gift of tongues and praying in the Spirit. Amen. See, the gift of tongues is a public gift. And so since it's a public gift, by necessitation, it needs the gift of interpretation to immediately follow so that you can receive edification. The Bible's very clear. If I get up before you and I just speak with tongues, only I was edified. There must be the interpretation either by me or by someone else so that you can be edified. See the difference between the two. He himself gave some to be apostles, apostolos, some prophets, prophetees, right? Some evangelists, evangelistes, pastors, poimen, shepherd, right? Teachers, didaskalos. He's given some to be. And he's given it for a reason so that saints can be equipped. When saints are equipped, ministry is worked. When ministry is worked, the body of Christ is edified. And that must happen until we come to the unity of the faith. I submit to you, church, we are not at that point yet. We have yet to arrive at the unity of the faith. Now, verse 3 does say that we are to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So I'm to keep the unity of the Spirit until I come to the unity of the faith. But we are not at the unity of the faith yet. But there it is right there. See, grace and measure is required for you to function as a prophet. Grace and measure are required for you to have the gift of prophecy. But nothing is required for the Spirit of God to use you as he sees fit. The only requirement is that you be filled with him. And if you're filled with him, make yourself. Now, the Bible does say this. Covet earnestly the best gifts. It says, covet earnestly the best gifts of the Spirit. That's at the end of chapter 12. But at the beginning of chapter 14, he takes it a step further. He says, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you prophesy. Why is that? Well, when the body is together, Christians are together, prophecy and tongues and different kind, I mean, and interpretation brings the most edification. The other gifts, it's not that they're not for us, but they you see them working more effectively in the realm of unbelievers. Right? You and I don't need a miracle to believe God exists. Now, we know he works miracles, but I don't need a miracle to come to the Lord. But you have seen in the gospel, there were those who had the hardest of hearts, but a miracle occurred. And the Bible said a report went out throughout the land and many believed on him. Miracles will bring about belief in the Messiah. Now, guess what? If the Lord wants to work a miracle in my life, have your way, Father. Yes. But I don't live by miracles. I live by faith. Amen. You live by faith. You don't sit around just waiting for a miracle to happen. That's foolishness. That's not faith. Are we together? All right. So we got it. We see clarity here. All right. Some are prophets. Some means not everyone. And there are those that have the gift of prophecy. But any one of us spirit-filled folk can be used by the Spirit of God in prophecy. Are we together? Do we have that? Amen. Well, I'll go ahead and I'm gonna go sit down now, guys. Okay, I'm gonna be done now.
Welcome, Dr. Price, to NDU. So, tell me, how was your experience today at NDU?
Like it was last time. Amazing. I've hung out with you guys before. Of course, one of the commencements. I was at the San Diego campus, so I've actually been to all three of the California campuses. And I enjoyed myself. One who loves to teach and one who loves to study, to come into an environment where those two things are prevalent. Where I'm ministering to students that are clearly hungry, who are being fed by instructors and a director who does the same thing, dispenses the word of God with clarity. It's just a pleasure to be here.
So what do you think about leadership and how important education is for leaders in the church today?
We have the responsibility of equipping saints. So if leaders aren't educated, then saints can't be educated. And there is a pattern in scripture that if that pattern is followed and adhered to, then there'll be growth in the body. So if saints are to be equipped for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, the responsibility is on the leadership or the ministry gifts to equip them. If we don't know what we're talking about, if we don't know what we're doing, then how can we give them anything to work the ministry? How can we give them anything to bring edification to the body of Christ? So it's dire.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you. Next Dimension University School of Destiny. Again, we welcome and thank Dr. Price for coming and sharing with us the word of God. He is a true worker of the word. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening into our broadcast. Now, log on to nextdimensionuniversity.com and register for your next season of formal training and preparation. If you do not know your calling or just want to enhance your knowledge, Next Dimension University is clearly your next step. So, embrace your destiny and be the best you can be. Yes, your destiny starts with us. Your destiny starts today.